I'm not very versed with the Bible. I'm not a theologian. I'm a very spiritual person, not religious. That's why I don't know the Bible very well. But I'll give you my experiences and that I've learned over the years on the topic of history. Of course, it's a brief history. The updating, there's so much to update. We don't want to spend the whole day updating. The last time there was some data, I've updated that was well over 7 years ago. So there's quite a bit that's happened in between. My coaching career, my play career, coaching career, has had its biggest challenges that have been turned into lessons that I think were not just lessons that came along, it's something that God planned for me to have. Very briefly, my background in Kibra was, and people usually ask me, how did you get from the unprivileged life to where you are now? And then I realized that I actually didn't realize that I was more privileged because I was around the same people, we did the same things, we had very many things in common. Very few times did we have people being dropped in school in cars. In fact, there was only the headmistress's car, and we had a teacher whose husband was a judge, and that's the only other car we saw. And the teacher and the daughters were being dropped in school, so to us it wasn't a big deal. My dad later on had a car, but he never got to school, so I had to walk all along. I learned a lot from him not giving me that privilege, so to speak, because then realized when all else fails, then you have to use the privilege God given in your limbs, in your senses to survive. So, first and foremost, I think the reason why this topic for me is very significant now is you look at our country today, we were with what's the gentleman outside? Stephen. And you remember the guy getting onto the road, and the other guy hooting so vigorously. And just because he didn't want to cede way to the guy who was already on the highway, he got in and his dad was shouting all manner of obscenities. That sort of thing has eaten into this society so badly. And maybe what we need to bring our kids back to, or ourselves as well, is to remind ourselves that every human being is important. Money has overtaken us in this society. We are judged by how much you earn, how much you can afford, how much you can do with the money. Let's assume today, right now, you didn't have money for basketball for those who came by Matatu. Those who came by cars, you can't drive your car, and you're going to walk the distance to get home. How many people will stay here forever just because you can't walk home? How many people? Is there anybody who will say, I'm not going home because there's no transport? In retrospect, we have people having billions and trillions of shillings. In their life, they don't need that money. I have an example. Today, if you have to survive, if you have to leave, there's a river down there, there's land. If we didn't have any money today, would we die just because there's no money? Because that's the value you put on the paper and you put on things that are invaluable. Yeah? So, in connection to that, it's just for us knowing that every individual in your life, outside, wherever you meet, is as important as the next, is as important as you. How many people like sitting in VIP areas? In fact, I felt very uncomfortable sitting in the front. How many people like VIP areas? Let's be truthful. How many people? Yes, let's just be truthful. Why do you like VIP areas? A VIP area is a place that is tended to a little better. We all want a better life. We all want something that is further, it's not normal, but we need to get it. Now, if our zeal for getting to the VIP is so much that we never look at what else is going on, that's when this thing creeps in. So that there's a VIP, and we have got people along the way. You'd rather step on them and get to the VIP to get better. And I'm not saying that you like that. In life, we get privileges because we have either achieved them, bought them, or acquired them. Yeah? So, what does Mishimiwa, the ones who got the primaries the other day, how they got the privileges? Anyone?
Mini box.
Who thinks they bought? Who thinks they bought? How many think they bought? How many think they acquired? And how many think they deserve? How many think they deserve? So write that. Now, the moral fabric is so indisciplined, we actually accept, it is very acceptable for somebody to tell you, take this and vote for me because I'll be able to make your life better. How are they going to make your life better? How? How? Who was it? Most of us are from Ruaka, right? So there's an MCA, of course. How's that MCA going to make your life better? Let me tell you how it's not going to make your life better. By not seeing him after you left him in 2008, in August 2017. That's how it's not going to make it better. How are we going to make our lives better? Anybody ever seen somebody throwing a bottle out of the window of the car? Somebody driving a beard. Who do you think is sitting in there? An MCA, right? An MP who can't decide. It's so important. He does not care about whether a child is dying in hospital. That's how bad it is. Our leadership has become the bosses because they're not disciplined. They don't value the next person's life. Discipline is a skill. It's something you do so often within certain rules, except by yourself or somebody else, that makes you be better in life. And better in life is also relative. My story about Kenya rugby and where it got. I started playing this game when I was in Form 1. In 1991 in my school. And nothing prepared me for 27 years later. Nothing did. It's one thing I could handle. It's one thing I could possess. It is that one thing that I thought, Benjamin, you can be good at this. And I'll give you an example. When I was growing up, I was a little plum. I don't look big now. This doesn't start. I can show you a picture of my third one. He's quite a big guy. I was that kind of boy. And we didn't have enough resources to go around. We're a huge family, and my neighbors are the ones who had the bikes. I wasn't very good at football, so we had to play. There's a game called British Bulldog that I was best at. So then I did a robot practice. Yeah. So when I grew up in primary school, I went to a school that didn't have much time to play. It was mainly school, which was only the primary school. So my interest in rugby grew because one of our neighbor's uncles played for Malaka. And once or twice we went there. But the funniest thing is, my best introduction to rugby was when my mother took me to a rugby match at the showground. I was very little then. She found it very exciting that huge men were running after each other, beating each other up for our ball. She found it extremely fun. In fact, she laughed her head out whenever a tackle was made. I was pretty young then. My mother gave back to me when she was really young. So I think that was like when she was about 18. She gave back to me when she was 16. So given her love for the game and not knowingly introducing me to it, and because I couldn't get into any other thing, this is the only one thing I could have. So that brought me to rugby. Naturally, I started getting interested in it. As time went by, by the time I got to my third year in high school, I knew the game so well. The coach couldn't tell me much, but I didn't tell him that he didn't know much. Yes, I lose my school, which was the best thing that was going to happen to me anyway. My father was never going to let me in any of his houses, so I opted to be the discipline boy. Just know it by myself and tell my friends. Needless to say, by fourth year, I was both captain and coach, and the interest grew. Now, nobody ever knows that. I don't think I've said it anywhere. The reason why I joined club rugby is because in 1993, when we went for the nationals, we got to the finals in Kandara, in Embu. Was it not Meru? Was it Embu? Embu, yes, it's Embu. Go to Kandara. And this was a fine rugby afternoon. Very good. We played our hearts out for the last 4 days, and it was a weekend, the Saturday. Now, for any of you who go to these games, school games, there's a girls' beat, or then there was, the girls' beat and then the boys' beat. It happened that rugby, being a relatively new sport then, being played in high school, it was played last. So, it was a packed crowd. We're playing Nakuru High. It was a packed crowd, and we had, there's a position called the flyer, which would be, he would be the playmaker of the team. I don't know how to refer to him in football. Maybe the number six, the guy who is creative, he's macho, he looks good, the Ronaldo kind of guy. That's cool much. But he's the hunk of the team, everything. So, Lawrence, what was his name? I told him, the reason why my 10th generation will play rugby is because of him. So, we had this very rare chance to win the game. And Lawrence, as he was, a very talented chap, stepped up and instead of doing a very simple thing, which was take the ball and pick it out for us to win, Lawrence decided to show the guys the showman that he is. They say the rest is history. But this one of me and Lawrence will never be history. Like I've told him, 10th generation of my children, I call it dynasty, who were playing the game just because of him. I remember when that happened, it really broke my heart because I thought that was the time. I've been faithful to the game 4 years, 3 years then, faithful, working hard, beating all the odds. Being the only person from Kibra who's playing this game, and the boys laughed at me when I was going for training. I thought, God, I've given it enough. And I thought, no, if it's all going to work here, it's going to work another time. And when I left school, I went to Impala. At that time, we just got promoted to the Kenya Cup from the lower tier. So we ran very well. So there's a group of myself and two other boys who came into the club. And because we came from the same area, we really gave it our all. It's the only thing that we could stand by. It's the only thing that we knew how to lose. So we did it at our best anyway. 2 years later, I became the captain on that side. And I remember once when there was trials, the Pinochet trials in 1996. And I was called upon, I was only 20, and I was called upon to replace a certain guy who was injured. And the coach then still did not believe that I was the caliber. First, the school I came from was not a rugby school. The club I came from was not the most liked, so I had to prove myself. I remember walking to that pitch on Sunday mornings. We used to train early Sunday mornings from about 9 o'clock to about midday. It's a long training session in the sun. I remember walking in there and telling myself in the corner before I got into the field. After the prayer, of course, I want to interfere with God. God is good, so you don't say the bad things when you're talking to God. So I said to myself, let me hit everyone so painfully. By the time I'm done, the coach will have no choice but to pick me. He used to say 15 minutes after the training started, he said, don't hurt anyone, these are your teammates. So I was part of the team. And that's how my journey started. And that was the first time getting into this busy life of Kenya 7 as was or is. So that was now a platform for me to carry on what was not done in my 4 years in school, to try and make better. And I remember my eldest brother is 9 years older than I am. And one day he came home and said, so what are you up to? He still stays in Saudi, he works there. So what are you up to? What is your plan? I said, my plan is to make rugby the best thing in this country. That was in 97, yes. So he looked at me and said, my good brother, why don't I find you something to do? And I said, that is what I'm going to do. I said it with so much conviction, I didn't understand what it was that was in me. It was burning. And that's what we say, it's a habit. You got into a habit of winning so much, you don't lose. When you lose, you have to carry on until you win. So this is 1997. And I told him I'll make rugby the best sport. And only recently, in 2016, he called me crying from Saudi saying, I will never, ever in my life doubt whether you're going to bring the clubs down or going to rain in Kenya. So he got the ban. That was that many years later. So the journey from then on of being convicted, having that conviction and falling through the dream. And I remember once once asking me, so what is the plan? I said, the plan is rugby. And she told me, now, in this house of mine, there's only a plan of college and then work. So the best thing you can do is, I think that a few things, a chair so that you don't sit on the floor, and a mat so that the floor is not cold. But find yourself a place that rugby is going to be the thing. She thought she was calling a bluff. But the next morning, I found a friend of mine and moved to a small house in Umoja. And we had our mat and chair. I said, this rugby is going to work. Sometimes what faith in you does. So often I would have to go back to her Sunday lunchtimes and talk. So how's rugby going? I have bruises and cuts and then it's going all right. But mom, can I get some bus fare? I said, but this rugby thing is going well. I said, it's going to work. Don't worry, mom, it's going to work. And so the struggle went on. The clubs were paying, the national team was going for way few tours. And eventually it broke through. 2003, we beat Australia in Hong Kong and we started going for 10 tours. There's a bit of money there, so there's one or two things. And that in itself brought up a few blessings. I got a contract to play in England. I didn't tell my mother until the day I signed the papers. That was in 2004. So this is a very funny story as well, and it's part of all this. I go, the boss of the club calls me and tells me, go to a certain building, you'll find so-and-so, there'll be a contract, you have a read, you have a ticket. When you get to Paddington Station in London, I'll take it. Cheap. Paddington Station in London is your safe bus station. He's got this thing worked out, and it's so elaborate about the planning and everything. So he tells me we'll be handed over a brand new road that's going to be a contract and all the instructions of how you need to get there. I've contacted the CEO, he'll contact you later. So I hung up, and I'd actually go and visit my mom. She's a hairdresser in town. So I'd actually go to visit her and say, I've got to go somewhere. I've got to go up Upper Hill, the Williamson house. So not to be mocked, I didn't ask her for bus fare. So I quickly walked there. I got there, found this lady, she explained everything. And after handing me the one brand new one, she handed me another brand new one. So I was wondering, they said one brand new one. She said, I won't open it up in case there's a reason why I can't go. So she'd asked for my passport, and I had to go to the British Embassy, I had a work permit done already. So I walked back to town, from Williamson House, just down, and it's the last season, and she's at Trenchard's Plaza. So I went to Trenchard's Plaza and took cover in a corner to look at it. There's stairs, and then of course there's a lift. So the stairs is rarely used, so I went to the stairs and opened the first envelope. So I pulled out the paper, had a quick read from the counters and everything. So I'm panting and I'm thinking, what's in the next one? It's smaller, it's lighter. So when I open it up, it's a bit dark in the stairway. So I try to look for lights, but there's none. There's no phones with lights there. So I know younger people can't comprehend that. So in that moment of being dazed, I walked into where there's a bit of sunlight. So I looked inside and saw some pink papers lined up. I said, wow, what could this be? I interacted with the British pound, but not in that altitude. So I was thinking, could she have made a mistake? So I'm thinking, should I call her? Should I call the boss? What happens? She must have made a mistake. So I pull out. Now I'm confident it's money. I've got someone a little more private. So I counted, and in there was £2,500. You know, when you tell God, okay, this is where I wanted to reach. I don't want to go there for this. So if you can, just let me enjoy this one. That was my first salary. It was halfway through the month, so he paid me half the salary that I was going to go on. I went to my mom and said, oh, mom, you know, remember what I've been telling you about me having, I might be going to some place to get a professional degree. I was like, yeah, she's up in my head. Mm-hmm. So what is it this time? What do you want from me? I said, mom, do you have a bit of time? How long will it take to reply? Luckily, she's about that. She said, just give me a few seconds. So she was down, I sat outside. There's a chair, there's a concrete bench. So I sat up there, pretty anxious, sweating. I think she was peeking through the window. What has this one done? Why is it so tense? What is it? And of course, my mother knows it from a mile away, especially when she gave birth to you, she's a little one. So she knows every fabric of you. So I'm looking at her, and I can't look straight because I don't know that laugh, smile, tell her in advance, go back, tell her, please leave, come back in. So she finishes and comes out. And then, this pose.
I'm sat here. Anxious. I don't know how to cross my legs, so I'm really anxious. Everything's on the side. So she comes and stands for me like this. You know how to predict that is. Everyone knows that their mother stands like this. I almost collapse.
You know, my mom is my friend, so she's thinking, if resistance, what has happened? I tell her, mom, sit down. What have you done? So, I sit down. So I open the envelope that has got, I got my contract and everything. So she's going through it, not making any sense of it. So she goes really quickly through it. I paid about £200 and £50 notes. I paid them out and put them on the car. So reading through them. What is this about? What is this about? It's not even taking time to read them. What is this about? And so I'm like, oh, relax. Next week I'm gone. Gone where? Huh? What? Have you told what's happening? Gone where? I was a bit like, so when I said gone, I could be leaving the family for all she cares. I decided to go away to Uganda or something, start a life there. So the man, the time has come. I'm going to pay my professional revenue. And for being my truest believer, of course I've been very sarcastic. So I gave her the money. Wow. You know, she'll think, well, maybe another 2-3 hours ago. So she opened the palm and said, what is this? I said, that's a British palm, that's a queen's money. So what's this about? I'm telling her, this is part of my salary. This is about 10% of my salary that I've just received a short while ago. I knew it myself. Wow. Yes, she went quiet and said, Mom, just because of you allowed me to prove you wrong, and I know what I'm about, this is the beginning of what you shall receive every single time. Video was not big then, and we never knew what happened. In fact, when I left in Australia, there was little in the media about it. I left my mom crying on that bench that day. With 200 pounds was not about. So what about 100 shillings? It's about 20,000 over there. So I left her crying there. For my entire 2 seasons in England, she never paid her rent, she never paid for her food, she never paid for anything else. I told her, Mom, just because I want you to tell your grandchildren one day about this story, you will tell them that in 2 years you never touched your money to do anything. And that was because of your son who thought there is always hope where people think there isn't. And what gets you there is that skill that you learn over time. It's very difficult. Life is not easy. It's not. And I had the man to say about families. It's not easy. Living together as people who come from different backgrounds, it's very difficult. You don't want to compound it with a lot of, oh, you've not done this, you've not done the other. You want to make the best out of this. Learn to be patient. Learn to do things that always bring out the best in the other person. Discipline is something that you learn to do, so you never stop it. It always grows in everyone. There's no one there who's 80 now and doesn't have to learn an extra point of discipline. Does anyone know how much time traffic jams take out of our lives every day? It takes out 8 hours out of a possible 24. 24, you have to sleep 8 hours as well. Or is there some real things, if you sleep less, you're more successful? Anyone? What's your opinion on sleeping time? Optimal. 6, 7, 8, 6 to 8. Now, we're reading a lot of things about successful people. These are the habits of a successful person. They don't rest. They're always in the flights. They don't spend time with their children. They have a lot more time to make money than all the other things that are natural in our lives. When your body says, go to sleep, go to sleep. Because God put it there, he wasn't seeing, he knew there was success. See, knew there was success. Yeah, so you're not teaching him. Actually, now I sleep less. This body, just give me a fine body. I sleep less. Yes, you get successful. Then, when the success reaches where you think it's optimal, then you start paying for hospital bills and being in hospital as well. Habits. Do things that God intended them to do. There's that inner spirit that tells you every time, don't throw that one. No, not there. say, ah, so you don't work at you. I'm paying taxes. True or false? Tell you true. How many people in a restaurant, in a self-service restaurant, has taken the tray back to the kitchen? Self-service. You get the pension. Eat. Take your pieces of chicken that's left over, and chips, and food. And go and ask somebody, where did I have this? How many have done that? Practice that. That's right. Practice not letting even the kids do anything out of what you do. Yeah? Practice just stopping at the zebra crossing. Yeah? Practice talking harsh to children when they're wrong. Let nobody lie to you. And everyone does not understand the language. You see, some of my kids, they have the fear of God. I instill the fear of God in them. But when they're walking there, they're down to me, oh, blah, 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 blah. They're not enemies. There's a lion through me. When I walk into the house and the shoes piling on the door, the Baba says, there are shoes on the door. There'll be as many of them in the house coming to clean up. Because there are consequences. So this thing has consequences. And the consequences of this thing, I'm not polite. I'm not polite. What happens if we all throw stuff in the river? Sooner or later, it will be flooded. That's harsh. And why do we want to teach our children that it's okay, that it's okay, it's not okay, and it won't be okay? Until that kid feels the pain of what it's not being okay. I don't care if my kid wants to pass 3 years old. They know the voice, they know the look, and they know that every, and those that don't know, the older brothers tell them, hey, I'm there. Don't try. A point in time, my eldest, Brad, is 18 now. His brother, Gabriel, walks in. And his quad is Uji. He's young then. He's about, I think, 200 and a bit. His quad is Uji on the floor. So he goes and gets a duster. He tells him, you know, if Baba finds this porridge here, he really smack you one. And he knows what a smack is. So he's not being explained to what it will be. So the next time Gabriel spills the Uji, he runs the duster before a smack comes. So it happened that the older ones have always taught the younger ones. So the youngest one now really makes mistakes. Yeah. Because he's been shown what a smart is. He's been told what a smart can really entail. Now, when you do that to your children and the people surrounding you, so they're disciplined enough not to make mistakes, it goes across the board. It's a domino effect. Point in time. We've got a household who made a mistake. I mean my bedroom, and my second one, who's a very religious guy, comes up and says, Ati, I'm not finding the other one. Ah, it's really, I'm here. Hey, you shall why is Makiwa na Baba? You know, this time he's about, I think he's about 10, so he says, we shall always love you, we're going to the computer. So, Auntie doesn't have to be smart because she's old enough. So if her mother is smarter, then I'm not going to be that much. But that is a discipline, so much so, that whenever they go out into somebody else's house, and the person whose house that is walks in with shoes and steps on the carpet, they all cringe. Ila is the last one. He says, there's a visitor who comes in. Has ever been to our house before? So the visitor is after him. I'm upstairs. So I hear the bell ring, and Ila is downstairs. I'm expecting Joanna, and tells me there's a visitor now, because I'm expecting the guy. So as I'm on the way down, I hear Ila is telling me, no, please remove your shoes. You can't step onto your carpet with your shoes. Please. So the visitor removes his shoes and puts them aside. You can imagine when that guy goes into a leader, I don't think he wants to take other people's money to do his own things. And it's just such small things that change society. Very, very small things. My last example, my little sister. She's the second last one in the family. We got into a matatu from Atari one day, from Sigma. And there were still the tickets there, paper tickets. So we walked from Gill House up to Insurance Plaza. And I find the bin, and I'm taking my ticket out of my pocket, and I dumped it. And I said, where's the ticket? So we had three back there. Where? I didn't see a bin. So there are three back there. We went back. She's called Irene, but she's an actress. You might know or might not know her. She picked a ticket because of many deaths. She went and dumped it. Irene has one son. I think when he wants to sneeze, he looks for a place where he should sneeze into. But that just shows you how discipline at a tender age will definitely change society. As ever too late, let's start from ourselves. Thank you very much. Thank you for your time. I hope I was interesting enough.